Interpreting graphs. Now, I've not put the units on this graph, but I've just put this example in to show you how you should go about tackling any graph that you get in the exam. And it may seem oversimplified, but will ensure that you don't make too many silly mistakes. Right, first up, the first thing you always look at is the axis, and then see if it has any units. If it doesn't have any units, then one, they're likely to ask you about that, and two, they're probably likely to ask you about some variables to do with the investigation. If they've deliberately missed one out, they're probably going to ask you what that is as well. Now, what you need to do, track along the bottom of the graph. In your description, you should describe precisely what is occurring when the variable on the bottom of the graph changes, and then you should talk about the effect on the other side. For example, in the bottom curve here, as light intensity increases, for the 15 degree C graph, it is a flattened curve and then remains constant at a low. Presumably, that axis is rate of photosynthesis. The first question says, simply describe. So, you simply describe what you see on the graph. The effect of temperature, you will have to pick two, which are simply different temperatures, but are the same CO2 concentration. For example, comparing this one with the top one will not be valid because the concentration is also changed. So you have to compare the lower one with the middle one. Clearly, what you say is, as light intensity increases, the curve for the 25 degree C middle line is steeper initially than the curve for the 15 degree C line, and it remains constant at a higher rate of photosynthesis. Therefore, temperature increases the rate. Similarly with carbon dioxide, we pick two where we compare carbon dioxide with the temperature constant. This is clearly the middle, and the top one, this one is 10 times greater than that one, which you can measure in your answer, as some exam boards and Excel will always credit manipulating figures. Now, clearly, once again, this stabilizes at a higher rate of photosynthesis and is a steeper curve initially. Therefore, the effect of atmospheric CO2, or relatively high CO2, is to increase the rate of photosynthesis. Number two, explain the limiting factors present at X, Y, and Z. If I just indicate, at X, we can clearly see, if we increase to a limit above X, we still get an increase in rate. Therefore, the limiting factor at X must be light intensity, because when we increase the light intensity, we get an increase in rate. At Y, the case is different. At Y, for the bottom line, the limiting factor for the bottom line is now not light intensity, because if we increase light intensity, we get no further increase in rate. Therefore, for the point Y on the bottom graph, the limiting factor must be some other factor, for example, temperature, which is indicated by the higher graph here, the relatively high CO2 concentration. Similarly, at Z, for the bottom line, clearly it's some other factor, as changing light intensity has no change in rate. Again, for the middle graph, it must be some other factor, as increasing light intensity has no increase in rate. But for the top line, at point Z, the limiting factor is still light intensity, because increasing light intensity still gives us an increase in rate. If we point those three out methodically like this, we should get all six marks. Okay, number three says, explain why an increase in CO2 levels lead to an increase in glucose produced in photosynthesis. Once again, it's explain, so they're asking for a molecular answer. So what you need to say is, an increase in CO2 will increase the substrate for the enzyme Rubisco, the first enzyme in the Calvin cycle. This will cause an increase in the product, which is glycerate phosphate, or GP. This will in turn lead to increased production of triose phosphate, or TP, and glucose is produced from triose phosphate. So, therefore, an increase in CO2 will lead to an increase in glucose. Number 4. Explain why an increase in temperature leads to an increase in the rate of photosynthesis. Well, every single time in biology, they ask you about the effect of temperature, it affects two basic fundamental processes, which are the same in AS or A2. They're either talking about enzymes, or they're talking about transport across cell membranes. In this case, the rate of photosynthesis is governed by enzymes. Therefore, an increase in temperature will lead to an increase in kinetic energy of molecules. Increase in kinetic energy will lead to a greater amount of enzyme substrate complexes forming. In this case, the Calvin cycle is a series of enzyme reactions. Therefore, it will go faster, producing a higher rate of photosynthesis. Once again at the bottom, we have suggest. Suggest how gardeners could produce a further increase in rate. Now, they're setting a little trap for you here because they know that some people will simply go, increase the CO2, increase the temperature. But what they're trying to point out to you here is that even with these factors, you still get limits. So, further increase in the rate is the key word there. To further increase the rate, well, changing the environment will prove limiting at various levels. So, if it's not the environment, we could change the genetics. In order to change the genetics, we can use these processes. Selective breeding, production of genetically modified crops, and using growth regulators, auxins or gibberellins, to boost the growth responses of our plants. Once again, if we fairly clueless on suggest, don't waste too much time on it.